Every attitude is false and small, while every action is beautiful and true.
Good evening, welcome to the third lecture. I prefer not to. Maybe by now the series has grown into a certain beginning of a culture that they have. We hope so. Arno Brandlhuber is our guest. As you can see, next week the Sankeras will be our guest, which will end up then the first semester of this year. I prefer not to is about kind of positive power of resistance. I'm not going to tell the whole story of Bartleby, the Scrivener, but Philip Ursprung did this last lecture in a very, very good way. So if you haven't seen the lecture, I would advise you to check on the website and video and check out Philip Ursprung's explanation on I prefer not to. Arno's name was actually quite early on the short list, because when we're thinking about somebody who could, in a positive manner, deal with architecture, policy, politics, resistance, I think it's quite clear that there are not a lot of architects around who, in a very consistent way, managed to do this through their, I don't know how long the practice now, 25 years, but in different forms. And as you know also, that I prefer not to is a kind of carte blanche invitation to the people on the list. And I think tonight we have a serious carte blanche in. So I'm very much looking forward to Arno's lecture. Arno, the floor is yours.
So basically, I prefer not to talk about all this was mentioned before. We will see
a film, 25 minutes, Legislating Architecture, which is like empowering the field of legislating as something to be regarded as design. Then I will do a very short lecture, maybe 30 minutes, and then I will do an interview with Peter Swinnen. He doesn't know yet, now he knows. And that's how it would all function. And now we see the film, 25 minutes. It's the film version we were showing at the Venice Biennale, and we were showing it last week in Montreal at the CCA, which will be, it's a project together with Christopher Roth, a filmmaker. Well, we first see the film and then we go on. 25 minutes. This is a ongoing research project. It started here at ETH with a seminar at Christian Carrer's studio with first-year students, more than 200. And this was a version, 25-minute version for a Venice Biennale. And I just brought those ones. One is for you. It's German and English. And there are many more, let's say, cases in it. And now we will launch it to a 90-minute film, which will be cut it completely different. So this was cut for an audience that's normally just passing by. So it's always based on two-minute cuts. That if you say, now it's enough, I have to go to the next booth. So we just see, well, there's something new happening. And part of our research, how do we switch that? So part of the ongoing research and also filming is now started in Canada, USA. And I would like to present you some of the very specific questions. Started with a mail by Tom Emerson. He sent me two slides about another Tom. If this first film was trying to give credit to a kind of design idea that's not based on the object-object, but on the legal field behind. This lecture now will focus slightly on, but what does it mean? Could it mean, if we suppose ourselves to be parts of a design project of laws, for the moment we try to implement a law in the country level of Berlin, and we find out it takes more than 4 years just to implement one little law. The law I just described shortly, then I start here. We just said everybody's allowed to extend above the existing height restrictions, with a penthouse, which you can sell, rent, whatever, if he rents out one the same space, the same building for a social price. It's a very simple law. But just to implement it, it takes really like so much effort and also people involved that it's at least as much work than a whole building. But I think in the end, it will change more of the city than if you would implement one new building. So this was a Tom's mail, and it was basically two images about another Tom, Thomas Jefferson. One is a crit, a drawing of a crit, and one is a quote that he was working as a nail maker. So Thomas Jefferson, born in 1743, this will be a history lecture. This is a very late quote, that architecture is my delight and putting up and pulling down one of my favorite amusements. So basically, he was trained in a lot of fields. There was no architectural education at that time. So he was more or less self-educating himself in mathematics, agriculture, but also he had one book, Andrea Palladio's The Four Books of Architecture. That was the first book on architecture he had. Later on, there was a French book. So this it's also now World Heritage, it's Monticello, his own house. He constructed in 1766, with the help, we have to quote that, with his own slaves and cheap labor. He did all of the drawings himself. Also, this kind of Jefferson style was read in that time already, a kind of strange take on old historic European sources. In 1774, he added a nail factory, basically with the help of the kids of his slaves. That were the main people working in that factory to gain their money. And in 70 already, he started as a member of the parliament in different functions. First in the state of Virginia, and that was a crucial point. So being trained as an architect, working as an architect, he wrote the first draft of the Independence Declaration. He became governor of Virginia, and in that time, in 83, he was already, as a governor of Virginia, drawing this kind of, you can imagine, so he's caring for his nail factory, his agricultural land, and he's drawing this kind of grid, kind of ability that I guess is coming from his training as an architect, no? To grid the whole country, like putting nails, like claiming land, which was really going from one coast to the other. It was basically after the Civil War in the States that they were the ones that came back from war were awarded a kind of land. It was numbered far away, so they all had to go west. And we all know this kind of images about this very strange, let's say, set up of urban fabric. So my point is, so he preferred not to act as an architect, but to become politician. But as a politician, he was acting in parts like an architect. And this scheme we will follow up now. He came to Karlsruhe, Germany, seeing this kind of very nice figure ground, all going radial to a central space, and he's still governor of Virginia at that time. And and at the same time, they wanted to construct Washington. So what he wanted first, that he could be the architect. Then he found out, well, as a politician, governor of Virginia, I can't be the architect. So he was clearly influencing the guy who was in charge to make him draw Washington on the base of his Karlsruhe experience. And in the end, he was the third president of the United States. So today we will follow some stories how you can move from being architect. We will only follow architects becoming politicians. We don't talk about Niemeyer, who was chief of the Communist Party. We don't talk, we have just some examples. When he retired as president, in the end, Jefferson was building the university in his own home country. And here you see some of his sketches. So he went back being an architect in his late years. And he also invented details. This is, you all know it, maybe it's a serpentine wall, which is a wall freestanding, and you can make it much thinner just by giving it the serpentine shape. Bogdan Bogdanovic was born in 1922 in Belgrade, trained as an architect in Belgrade itself. He mostly followed a kind of academic career. But he started being in the, let's say, in the resistance there, in the kind of liberation of Yugoslavia, in the partisans movement. And he started working at the faculty in 50, and he became the dean of the faculty in 1970. In the same time, from 52 to 81, so even longer than being dean of the faculty, he was building 25 of those partisan monuments. So that's basically his architectural oeuvre. So in this, when he was dean of the university, he tried to implement a kind of radical reform within the university. That is not a top-down teaching, that students could even choose on what they would like to be trained at, that the assistants, the Mittelbau, how we call it, has the same rights than the professors, and for sure he was more or less excluded within 3 or 4 years in that structure. So then he went to a private-owned house and founded a school of architecture, which was called School of Architecture Philosophy in Mali Popovic, which is like 45 kilometers away. And when we visited in 2009, it was abandoned. Still, you had in the basement this kind of drawings, and it was a kind of very strange take on architecture, like how form would directly influence people's behavior. Then he became mayor of Belgrade from 82 to 86. Basically, what was the task there, that he was not acting like the chief of the administration, which he was as well, but he was the first one among all the others to represent the whole city. So basically, he was more or less opening sports events and was completely unable to fulfill the public requirements. So we will talk about that later, what public requirements could mean. But one thing was really interesting. He installed the competition 85 for the new Belgrade urban structure improvement. So it was already existing, but all the spaces in between was a huge competition. And just to tell one of the participants, Henri Lefebvre, who wrote the famous Ride to the City, was participating with Jean Renaudie and René Gaillostet, the ones who did the very interesting housing in Ivry belonging to Paris. Even he could not make them enter the final round because the text that Henri Lefebvre was distributing was 40 pages and was only one page allowed. In 87, Milosevic came into power, and he had a very, let's say, influential speak, like a radical shift from Titoism to nationalism. The day after, Bogdan Bogdanovic wrote an article, public one, still being the mayor of Belgrade, complaining about this new nationalist movement. And it took maybe 3 weeks, 4 weeks that he was under house arrest. And he stood under house arrest from 87 to 93, then he emigrated to Vienna. Mariano Arana, I didn't know him before at all, born 33 in Montevideo, Uruguay. He did his diploma in architecture at that school, also in Montevideo, Uruguay. And he basically went directly through the, not through the public sector, but as there was a big shift in Uruguay and a lot of South American states at that time, he became architecture and coordinator living for a kind of huge cooperative. So this cooperative was building thousands of apartments within very few years, but it was all based on empowerment by the users, by the workers who did the building sites. So it's a real like very new take in the South American surrounding at that time. But it was either a governmental institution nor a private one. So today we would call it an NGO. Very much based on social movements in that time in Uruguay. And one of the most famous ones is this cooperative Wickmann, which was built with Eladio Dieste, which is still existing today, and most of them are still existing today. So he had a rather clear career in this cooperative, or leading this cooperative, till the military part of Uruguay took over in 73. So more or less was unemployed for 10 years. In 84, he founded a party together with a leftist party, with Frente Amplio. And 84, they already somehow knew that the military regime will come to an end. So in 85, it was the end of the military regime. He became the chairman first of heritage, of artistic and cultural heritage. Then he became also dean of the institute, director of the Institute of History of Architecture. And then he was became candidate as mayor for the in Montevideo. And in 89, he became, first he became senator of Montevideo, then mayor. And what, and then it comes into being that what he had learned before in this cooperative, like small scale units to make decisions, like to give the power to the people. So Montevideo was then partitioned into 18 or 19 districts with local governments. So just as they, even there, this politician could not have acted like that if not being trained as an architect. I do it rather quickly. He ended as being the minister, state minister now from Uruguay, minister of housing and spatial planning and environment from 2005 to 2008. Anca Petrescu. She is born 49 in Romania. She's a very special case. She's trained as an architect, also in Bucharest, and her diploma work is what's called the Arsenal Hill, which is a very nice located situation, in that time still being completely covered with buildings. 73, so some years later, in 77, there was a huge earthquake and most of the buildings there were destroyed. Most means were only 35-38%, but Ceausescu in that time, in 77, took the chance to remove it all and to start the huge competition of reconstructing the center, as it was called. Competition for the reconstruction of Bucharest city center, but basically he wanted to build his presidential palace. And as we can see here, this competition, there were only 15 offices invited, but still here you can find Anca Petrescu in the image, and it was based on her name, because the wife of Ceausescu, her born name is also Petrescu, so nobody would deny her access when there was all the meetings. She was asking her professor, where she had studied and made diploma, whether she could participate in his team. He denied, but he gave her at least the plans. So she was always around when all these decisions were made. And she became friend with the son of Petrescu. Here you see another meeting she has with son of Ceausescu. Here you see her with Ceausescu, so she took any chance, so she was really addicted to that project. And here you see her in 81, 3 years later, showing the final proposal of to build this presidential palace to the wife of Ceausescu, Elena Ceausescu. Then she was appointed chief architect in the age of 32. Quite young, chief architect, she was working there with 1 million workers on this building site. It was only local material, local means like the whole country. She had 700 architects to help her. And it was in that time, so when it was nearly finished, the second biggest building in the whole world after the Pentagon. And it was enormous luxury. It was in that time not finished, so we are in 89 now. And you might know about the end of this regime. So Ceausescu left with this car. And this is the images of the video when he and his wife were shot after they were caught in a kind of under-earth tunnel going out of the palace. Even the palace was not finished. The Romania, he was already using it. Two-thirds were finished. So this Anca Petrescu then worked for the Club Med in Florida to remake it in the interior, like for 4 years. Shenji had a commission the same time for the Sheikh's Palace in Abu Dhabi, which is basically a hotel, let's say the most luxury hotel in the world in that time. Then there was a new shift, let's say. Around 2002, they started to implement in the north part, the unfinished part of the Ceausescu Palace, to install the Museum for Modern Art. And then 2003, she came back to participate in the finishing of the building because she was the only one who really knew how to read all these different plans. It was a team of 700 architects, so she was asked to come back. And she ran for the state elections for ultra-nationalist party. She became member of the parliament. And which is somehow interesting, she said in an interview for her own biography that she ran for office only to receive permanent access to the building that houses the parliament since 1994. She died in a car accident in 2014, and she was her dead body was laid out in the People's Palace. So she was really addicted to this one and only building. But as an architect, she somehow managed to enter the political field in that case, just to rest and to stay in that building. Netanyahu, that's a little longer, born in 49, Benjamin Netanyahu. He was trained at the special forces from 67 to 72. Though that's the special force of Israel if there's any really risky job to do. You see him on the left side before, they always had to go to a kibbutz to prepare for the military service. He did a bachelor in architecture and a master in business management at the MIT in Boston. So he was trained, again, as an architect. He was explaining when he ended and told them why he would like to study two subjects at the same time. He explained them that that they have to care for social housing and they have a housing shortage in Israel. So he was accepted to study these two courses at the same time. Interesting enough is this Leon Kreuscher, who was part of the media lab at that time, which is very influential on technologies of surveillance, of everything we would know now of Google Street View and so on. So this Leon Kreuscher is the only one who gives a lot of interviews still about, or gave a lot of interviews about his student Benjamin Netanyahu. He made it clear that he didn't have 4 years to get an undergraduate degree. You can read yourself. So, but you can imagine, so there is another quote that he was really studying as an elite military trained person. So he very fastly, very quickly, as well economics and architecture. He had started his architectural master. And again, this Leon Kreuscher says he finished it by one fourth, but he has finished his master's in business management and he had started a doctoral program in political science. And at a certain moment, he left overnight the school. So in July 4th, 1976, my country's terrorists from RAF took an airplane together with terrorists from Palestine and flew it to Uganda. And mainly there were Israeli travelers on board. So in that time it was Idi Amin, who was the, let's say, dictator of Uganda, and he drove there with a black Mercedes limousine to welcome the terrorists. So when the Israelis saw that, they came up with a plan. So they flew in with a military machine painted differently, and they had two black Mercedes, the same type than Idi Amin was using. They flew in. Among those, it was the same elite group that Netanyahu was in. Among those is his brothers, is his brother. So they managed to drive in, drove slowly with the black Mercedes to the plane, shot the terrorists. The brother of Netanyahu got shot. They took all the Israeli people on board into their plane and leaving. It was a 65-minute action. Today we couldn't understand that, but in that time, 65 minutes was very short, even like the whole information system. After that, you might know some of those films. In the same year already, the first came out with Douglas, Helmut Berger, the nice Orson Helmut Berger, and Joni Netanyahu, which is a brother of the Netanyahu we are talking about now, is played by Richard Dreyfuss. And the next one came with Charles Bronson. So for the the brother of Netanyahu became really a national hero. So strangely enough, there are some years where nothing is known, 76 to 78. In 78, Ben Nittai, how Netanyahu called himself when working for the Boston Consulting Group, took over an NGO which was dedicated to his brother Jonathan Netanyahu, who was dying in that kind of rescuing action. He did some other stuff in rim industries, it's like the IKEA of Israel. But then he became first like on the diplomatic corps. He became the deputy chief of mission of the Israeli embassy in Washington. He became the ambassador of Israel at the United Nations. He became foreign minister. He's coming into parliament in Israel itself, and in 96, his first time voted as president in Israel. Very against Shimon Peres, which was a very tiny advantage of 1%. He loses against Barak and comes back as a president in 2009. So, can we relate him being trained as an architect to his practice as a politician? In this case, it appears quite clear. This I won't show you. So he's acting with plans also at the United Nations already. He uses the kind of marking, drawing at the United Nations. So all techniques learned as an architect. And basically, which is an argument that Il Weizmann was working on for years, that the settlement policy is becoming a weapon in the West Bank. We all know about it. I don't want to put that further, but just to say, so it's really clear that we can trace back this training to his acting as a politician. After the Arabic Spring, Obama had a speech where he was clearly positioning himself against this settlement policy, which was not the case before. This was in 2009. Since then, there's a kind of very difficult relationship between Israel and the United States. Even if he was denying that he's still going on with the settlement policy, when 2010, Biden, the vice president, came to Israel to arrange, to clarify what could be the subjects on the first visit of Obama to Israel, they announced 10 minutes after the machine has landed, they announce new settlement of 16,000 houses behind the Green Line. Green Line is like the Palestinian part. So that's just to show that there is clearly new building, and I don't want to go further on that. But just to let some others speak, what I see is much more emphasis on construction in the most problematic settlements, which are the potential deal breakers for a two-state solution. So clearly an architectural take on, let's say, internal policies. And this is a caricature of Benjamin Netanyahu. It's not, let's say, I don't want to put any personal opinion at that moment, but there is this discussion going on, and this cartoonist Carlos Latouf is now on the top 10 anti-Israeli, anti-Semitic list published by the Simon Wiesenthal Center. Marie Fleur Agema, she is born in 76 in the Netherlands. She's trained in this fabulous Gerrit Rietveld Academy in Enschede. She made a Bachelor of Arts in Architecture. So now I show you, it's an artist who tried to reimagine her master thesis, no, the bachelor thesis. So she did, when she finished the study, she was designing a prison. And the prison, interesting enough, it was basically, it was also namely in the description of the project, that outside is not longer existing, so outside the other. So it's all about complete control. So I just show you how the phases of her, how a prisoner should be treated were made architecture in that phase. So that's phase one. You have one window. It's meant to break the prisoner's resistance. Phase two, the habitation, how she called it, you have already two windows. And you have a vegetable garden, though this is the vegetable gardens in her design. It was all made to a one-to-one scale in an exhibition by this artist, Jonas Stahl. Phase three, the way to come out. It's a type of commune in which the prisoners have to learn to operate collectively. So you have three windows. This is the common kitchen. I would like to show you all the work of Netanyahu at the MIT, but it's getting too long. But in this case, it's quite nice because it's a recent, let's say, reinterpretation and visualization of her work. And the fourth phase is you are allowed to live in a kind of reconstruction of a normal neighborhood. Reconstruction of a normal neighborhood. And all the time you are filmed by hidden cameras. So it's a complete control where the prisoners live at a simulated life in order to verify whether they are yet fully capable of functioning within society. And that's how they would live in that time. I read one quote of her. When you extend the power of architecture to interior and furniture, you could define power as a characteristic of a building on interior itself, and the effect of that power on the usage and the user of that space of furniture. A chair with a straight back forces its user to sit in a certain way. Thus, any piece of furniture, any interior, and any building has its own way of exercising power onto its user. So that's a quote of her much later, because she became ill in 2001. That's a photo posted by her boyfriend, her husband, Leon de Jong. And she became a cancer where she can't move her fingers. So she had to stop. She was working as an interior architect at that time, so she had to stop that job. And first she joined the party of Pim Fortin, who was one of the... Well, in 2002, the first populist in Holland, then being killed. After that, she's joining in 2006 the party of the Freedom Party of the extreme nationalist Geert Wilders. And in the elections 2006, they got like 9 seats in parliament. So she became the right hand of the Wilders and Nero's confidant. She was the spokesman for healthcare, for prisons, and implementing lots of the new and much more restrictive treatment of prisoners in the Netherlands in that already. And since then, she is talking about the Islamization of healthcare, which is based on the fact that in Germany, we have a lot of healthcare-ing done by Turks, by Romanians, and a lot of Muslims in the Netherlands. I'm interested in interior. That's why she is sitting in the parliament. I'm interested in interior in which living, working, sleeping, recreation, studying, relaxing, and working out takes place 24 hours a day as a total interior. In the same location, often even in the same building. Examples of such a total architecture are a nursing home, a hospital, or a prison. That's one of her speeches in parliament. So now we make a shift. Be aware. Peter Swinnen, born in 72, no, he studied architecture at St. Lucas in Brussels and the DRL at the AA. He's currently a guest professor. He invited me today, so thanks a lot. And on the ETH website is written, he's founder of CRIT Brussels. I haven't found anything on CRIT Brussels, so I will ask him later on what CRIT could be. He started with this practice, his founder and co-founder, I think, in 51N4E. You might all know this work, so I don't go for it, but maybe one quote, every attitude is false and small, while every action is beautiful and true. So that's a very interesting part. We can relate to that later on. Every attitude is false and small, while every action is beautiful and true. Peter Swinnen, though, that's the official announcement of the office 51N4E. Peter Swinnen, partner in 51N4E, has been appointed as the upcoming state architect for the Flemish region. From July onwards, he will supervise and steer the quality level of new urban and architectural developments in Flanders. He will equally focus on the international relevance of the region's potential. Peter Swinnen remains active partner at the office. And by an interview you gave with Arjen Ostermann and Brandon Cormier, it was quoted, as Flemish state architect, Peter Swinnen is advisor to the Flemish government, being non-political, we have to say, because he was the third Flemish Baumeister, no, he was his first, which was meant to be a non-political work. Yeah, we come to that. To advise, is advisor to the Flemish government on architecture, infrastructure, urban design and landscape. He is assigned to contribute to prepare and execute the architecture of the Flemish government. Now it's becoming closer to the political field. What he did was, interesting enough, he moved out of the old office where the Baumeister was sitting to an own atelier. It was a kind of gallery space, a physical space, that allows for public exchange. And now some more quotes. The space we are currently in, so that's a quote of you, a showroom annex atelier in the 1950s shopping gallery in Brussels, blah, 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 is my office. My people are housed a few blocks away in a back office. When they want to see me, they come over. It's the same for the public line. That's an interesting moment, no? That the public line is the same than the co-workers. In a way, the architecture community is a tool and not the end. Our clientele is the public client. He clearly stated that he wanted to include the international scale. That was new for all of the Flemish Baumeisters. All the ones before would never claim an international scale. And another, because I'm really interested in that, I said that we are continuing our film project and interviews and. So, one more quote. I think it's normal that quotes that I have to invite myself, as a governmental apparatus is so vast that sometimes people don't know who to talk to, or it takes too long. So I offered my service, please use us, in the same interview than mentioned before. I'm not. And then another interview for the Venice contribution in 2012 for the biennial. I'm not interested in Venice as a fair, but as a moment. Things should be ready up to a point, and I want to mingle this cultural event with the actual making of policy. So that's the point where I became really interesting. So he's trained as an architect, and clearly in that moment, he also publicly claimed the field of policy, not only like political acting as an architect, but the field of policy. And in 2014, you left or you quit or you all quit the office 51N4E, and 13, sorry. Wrong quote, 13. And, but that was in 2015 when official architect Peter Swinnen dismissed, so that's the official quote, dismissed with immediate effect, the Flemish government has voted to dismiss official architect Peter Swinnen with immediate effect. His term of office was due to run until June this year, so it was four months earlier. Neither the government nor Swinnen's office have given any detailed explanation for the sudden decision. I have three last images which refer to the American elections. I will show them later. And maybe we could do a little talk on how far did you prefer not to be an architect anymore as you stepped out of... And I have prepared some questions. Maybe we could do that with light and public. And maybe a microphone for you. Do you have another microphone? Shall we both speak up loud?
How should we organize us?
Should we sit together? And we share this microphone. And I think going back to the film, where our statement would be that even the lawmaking, though entering the field of policy, is a work of design. So how did you, as a Baumeister, and we have to say it sounded a little bit maybe crude or bad, but he was most influenced to give chance to Jan de Wilde and all the others, so a whole, the Belgian, let's say, architectural scene wouldn't exist in that kind of way how it is now. So how did you regard yourself longer as an architect, or more, how did you come to this kind of statement for the biennial that you would like to make it a political case, a kind of momentum, to use a momentum at the biennial?
Well, I must say you've been very, in a way, kind and hygienic about the quotes, in the sense you could also have shown things which were much more brutal, especially from the political party. Maybe it would have helped also to make it clear how, let's say, brutal it can be. I accepted the position. I was never a real candidate. But when they asked me to, in 2010, to be on the shortlist, I was looking back at the practice of the office, so 51N4E, for 15 years, more or less. And in a very unconscious way, maybe, I think we were already quite a political practice, especially maybe also with the work in Albania, where, again, in a very natural way, we slipped from being invited architect into informal advisors to politics.
Maybe I may ask a detail here, because some of the quotes we didn't use were that you were trying to implement yourself. So that was from the political, let's say, animal that you were trying in Albania to implement yourself in Tirana as a kind of Baumeister, and at the same time wanted to have commissions. So that was one of the... Maybe you can just refer to it as a...
it's a lecture in itself in a way, so maybe we should do this later. But the one thing I learned from those 5 years is that extremely difficult, maybe if not impossible, to, at least for the public eye, for the political eye, to be both architect and to work for public service in a way, on a political level. And I mean, when I was talking to the headhunter in 2010, I told him literally, said, don't choose me. I prefer not to. Don't choose me because I will do this, this, and this. So I told him that I was going to try to open up this field of Baumeister, which I think in itself is a valuable position, but at the same time, it's also a very feeble position, you know. It stems from 1999 when Bob Faret, who's a Belgian architect, was actually chosen. He's a very clear-cut architect to guide, in this case, the Flemish government, but also the local authorities to choose the right architect in a way, through commissions, through competitions. I personally feel there is very quickly we come to the actual limit of what architecture can do in society if it's not supported by the right people. So, and maybe that's my flaw. I mean, I believe in architecture as an architect, but if I, let's say, play the field of policy making and politics, but even in Venice, I think architecture is a very feeble medium. And how can we still, because I still believe in it, so what kind of tools, what kind of interesting lures can we as a discipline develop to infiltrate politics? That was, in a way, my big question.
And especially on the, how to translate it to English, the Landesentwicklungsplan, you were really interested in participating in that plan making, which is normally made by the ministry itself. You know, how to become influential, how to become, so that was your question. Maybe you could a little bit explain on, because it might have been also part of the struggles in the end, you know, that if you try with the tools of architecture that you were trained and the kind of making connections in the whole field, but like focusing on something that's basically a ministry work, no? The Landesentwicklungsplan, well, how would you translate it? The country development plan, which is made every 20 years, we have to say?
Or less,
but in that case it was already like 16 years old, 15 years old. So you were really focusing and also doing research on that, like collective housing and all the topics you had already done. So how did it happen that this conflict was arising by trying to take over also control or to contribute to this Landesentwicklungsplan?
Maybe what Snodzi showed, so, and his position, so his seven rules. I mean, he could do it because it was a kind of confined community. There was a kind of one-to-one level of trust. If you would translate that or multiply that in scale to a region, it doesn't apply anymore. And I tried to do that because I thought, and I still think, that we as an architectural discipline are able to, let's say, oversee things in a different manner. And we can I mean, of course, this kind of plans, probably in Switzerland you have them as well, Germany, heaven for sure. Yeah. They made up for 20 years, so in a way, it's kind of taking hostage, a lot of things taking hostage. So this was the ultimate moment, the kind of time slot of maybe 12 months to, in a very positive way, open up the envelope and to say, well, think of this, this, and this. And in that sense, I mean, the way Snodzi described these rules, we try to do the same thing. And it doesn't work.
Why?
It doesn't work because it's, I think, too it's too abstract. And because, I mean, again, a politician, maybe apart from the ones that you showed, but normally a politician, they can't read these kind of rules or they can't understand. So what they need is pilot projects. And this is what we invested in for 5 years, is, for instance, on collective housing, in care.
Productive landscape.
And these pilot projects were real architectural projects done with really, really good architects. But actually, we got the permission from the ministers. So in a way, it's not everybody was against us, what we're trying to do. So all of the ministers, they gave permission, for instance, to open up the limitations, the legal limitations, and say, well, test. I give you 5 years. We'll build five projects in these 5 years with real clients, real budgets. And then after that, we actually bend it back to legislation. So architecture all of a sudden becomes a means to change legislation, which I think is one of the main purposes, in a way, so of architecture.
Could you explain the some of the five cases, how that would have influenced the legislation after re-evaluating them? Because it's a very interesting topic, now to use architecture as a tool to change legislation.
Yeah.
So not to go into legislation, which was the film about, but...
For instance, talking about Jan de Velde, so he was also in the pool. He was working with a client who was a private client, so with private money, but wanted to do, invest in public good. In Belgium, in Flanders, this is hardly possible. So we managed to find these cracks in legislation to make it possible. But the only way to do it was because there was a very clear-cut project. I mean, in the end, the project stopped as well, I must say. But that's due to other parameters. But because of this clear-cut architectural project, like a signature project, all of a sudden people around the table felt there was a shared project. There was a joint project. It was not a kind of abstract babbling out in the air somewhere. So again, I think architecture for me, almost the only definition that interests me, I'm not interested in architecture for the sake of architecture, is when architecture is a means to achieve something else. And this something else is a public good, full stop. And what we tried to do at the Baumeister was to develop tools like the pilot projects. And again, I mean, it's and probably you can't grasp it right now, and it's quite complex to explain. But it was like, I mean, if architecture is at the end of the development, it's not an end station. What if architecture becomes a kind of middle station? You can't predict the end station. I mean, something else will come out of it. But are you prepared as architects, as future architects, to engage in such projects, which means that you're giving up a certain level of control, a certain level of maybe autonomy? But the position of architecture, and again, it differs from country to country, but at least, for instance, in Belgium, architecture is not seen as something crucial. It's a kind of extra. It's a nice to have, you know. So again, for 5 years, we tried to have at least in these pilot projects to make sure to the politicians that it's crucial. And in a way, it works because the Minister of Healthcare, he has now ordered the second generation of pilot projects. And my small dream was that when every minister is installed, he or she would say, well, where are my pilot projects? I want my pilot projects in order to change my specific take on legislation. And that's something else, then, for instance, doing, because that was the main purpose of Baumeister, is guiding competitions. I think that's one thing to do, but I don't believe in competitions anymore, to be honest.
So you were mentioning today that you were working on three books that were not done because you were fired 4 months before the normal end. So what was the content of those books?
Book one was on pilot projects, so it would have helped me today to explain you the full story. Book two was actually on the regional plan. So it's called, where I intervened on a level, maybe that was not my position, but still, there was enough content to make a good book out of it. And book three was actually something where I wanted to do what you're now doing. I was interviewing people, architects, people in the cultural sphere, in the political sphere, especially also in the economical sphere, to talk about architecture and the relevance of architecture. So to open up, again, I feel architecture is too often still very much enclosed unto itself. And we can say architecture is political. I mean, we had in the newspaper, for instance, during a whole week, a discussion whether architecture is political, yes or no. Because I've written a piece on a certain political party, and of course architecture is political. But there are very few, and I'm really glad that you showed what you showed today, but there are very few real practices of political practices of architecture. And I think we're deeply in need of these kind of practices.
And I can add that we were really jealous in Berlin in that time. Even Regula Lüscher, she said, she would like to be able to act like you had been acting as a Baumeister, because he really took decisions towards really architecture, no? So that was something that's normally not the case. I have two last questions, and maybe then you have a question. Why did you stop with your office 51, and or why did they stop? It's a kind of, I don't want to...
There's no secrets about it. It's still, so 51 and 4E is still continuing. My two former partners are still doing, I think, a fantastic job. For me, it was always a 15-year project. And the offer I had put on the table was to stop together and like stop and reboot. We stop together and we form a new office, but with different kind of a different way of working. It was a three partner office with, let's say, 25 people. And again, and I mean this in a positive way, the power of the architects for me was quite limited. Because again, the tools that you were on, offered, at least in that part of Europe, like competitions, I think they are very limited. It gives you like a very small opportunity of really changing things. And probably you will contradict me, and maybe it's the start of a real discussion. So, I mean, to be honest, I didn't believe anymore in this kind of office structure to have a real impact. And I always said, and I mean, I'd rather do something completely different that if we can't have a real impact. So I had the feeling that the impact level was slipping away.
The good design,
and we discussed...
Crit would be a follow-up in a kind of different way.
And Crit is a follow-up in a different way, in the sense it's a one-man office. But I work with a lot of people in a lot of different formations. But also linked to that, I mean, I'm not joking when I say I don't believe in competitions. So the energy and the money that you normally put in competition, I'm now putting into looking for projects which I think, and with my fellow people, think that should happen, but are not yet a commission, don't yet have a brief, are not a competition. So we go undemanded for to people, to institutions, to say, well, we think this project should happen there. And we try to put the things around the table and try to put it together. And this is a starting practice. So I can't, hopefully in 2-3 years' time, I can hopefully show you some real effects. It has a double effect. It's both refreshing, but it's also, of course, very, maybe almost offensive. Well, in the sense that it's too direct for certain people as well. I mean, if you as an architect go directly to somebody, say, well, I think we should work together. And actually, it's about spotting clients who don't know yet they are clients, which I think is an intriguing science. And for me, part of architecture. So, and also something what we try to teach at the studio. I mean, because I think the clients, the things which are available, don't give enough room for real social impact.
So shall we open up to your questions? Any questions?
I have mixed feelings about the used position about competitions. Isn't it that...
use that and open the bag.
When you say that competitions are like not a good solution, but isn't it about the balance that for public commissions there is a whole spectrum of possible commissions, and for some cases like competition is still the best answer?
Well, yes, but it depends on what is required and the loss of energy. I mean, I'm not saying anything new, of course. Mm-hmm. It's getting worse and worse, in my view. The loss of energy, the loss of money, the loss of intelligence, mm-hmm. which is, because if you don't win, it goes into a drawer, and most of the time doesn't come out unless it's mm-hmm. published in an architectural magazine that is read by a very limited public. So there is a big loss going on. So I truly believe in competitions, and this is also what we try to do at the Baumeister, that we ask very little of you, and that we try to help the public client to choose on the basis of almost kind of trust, you know, kind of gut feeling trust. The problem is that on the other hand, that architects, in a way, they couldn't withheld themselves to draw the lost toilet, you know, on the plan. So on the one hand side, we were trying to say, well, do as little as possible, but just make a very clear statement, and then we'll see what happens. From the architectural discipline point of view, most of the architects, and I understand this fully, I mean, it's not that I'm came with full plans for which they were not paid. I mean, the economical, again, in Switzerland it's different, but Belgium, Holland, Germany, France, the economical system linked to architecture is a very, very rocky one, no? I mean, out of your experience?
It depends.
Depends?
Yeah, depends on the client, the competition. And,
you mean if you win?
No, yeah.
So, I mean, I'm not against competition as such, but there is this kind of...
Use it that we have it all on tape for the...
There is this kind of surplus, and I'm really interested to hear your thoughts also about it. There's this kind of surplus of, I mean, and yeah.
No, but it's just because, like, seeing it from the outside as a...
Use it that we have it on tape.
No, because there is something like that is intriguing and sad at the same moment, is that seeing it from the outside as someone working for an office that took part in competitions you organized as a Baumeister, and which were a great platform, because you invited a nice panache of experience and young architects, and so for like that was that kind of competition where you said, okay, like everybody's got a chance. And we'll be judged on the project. Okay, but and then it seems to me, that's my interpretation, that somehow you were seeing it from the inside, like you saw all the problems, but still that the competition for the architect is one of the best possible ways to design, like.
Especially you named it the panache, what's the French name? A nice selection, melange of architects. So that was one of the, let's say, or the in public, like one of the quotes against your kind of work, that you selected a group of, let's say, friends more or less, but what we in Germany, and especially I guess also here in Switzerland, these competitions are regarded as being highly democratic, no? Because everybody has the same chance, so maybe you could, and but you had designed it that it's maybe more sufficient to go the other way, not to have this open competitions, but to select a handful talented young architects, which made, we have to say, a lot of the Belgium, let's say, starters now, because they got the chance to build and to make the experience and to show their work in reality.
But maybe also linked to that, Arno, is that in 1999, when Boffaret started this beautiful system of open call, the public sector was still public and was still building and was still operating as a public sector. The last 8 years, I mean, the private sector moved in. And I must admit, I mean, we tried also to install a kind of variation on the open call for PPP, so public-private partnerships. And we did quite a lot of projects for schools under the flag of PPP. And I can assure you, the open discussion, the potential for trust in a jury is completely gone. So again, I mean, I'm all for a Baumeister. If the Baumeister has, let's say, behind him a public government, that still wants to work in a way and doesn't, you know, with every investment they had, say, well, we'll go to the private sector. Because the private sector I mean, there are other parameters in decision making when the private sector, I mean, again, I'm not saying anything new, but what kind of tools as a discipline could we, and this is maybe Michel, I mean, I don't think as an architect, you're only on the receiving end. So you don't only get, best case, invited for a competition. I think you can be at the kind of forerunners end as well. So, I mean, I would be interested as an office, kind of with a certain weight, how could you do both, you know? How could you initiate projects? And maybe not only for your own office, but, you know, to...
So to close it, maybe we could also... Okay, there's a question. The last question.
Okay, so... I don't know, I sort of... this question has been forming in my mind for longer, so now you're both on the spot, so I wanted to ask it. Christian Keretz said in his excerpt in the video that the only book that the architect should read is the text of law. And then you sort of introduced this kind of pilot projects and the figure as a Baumeister. So when you put this together, is a text the medium, or is the text as a medium enough, or does there have to be more than a text to do policy in general? Like, because law is always a textbook. I don't know.
A question to both of us?
Yeah, I don't know if like, yeah, this would be my question.
So I would answer that this law book, the building law, the building regulations, is a kind of archive of experience. We made things a long time. So it's always a little bit behind, but it tries to describe the kind of how are we allowed to build towards our neighbors in the public, how do we have to act in the kind of common, let's say, source book, if you read it in the nicest way. But I found out, I started my practice as fighting against it, but to find a trick how to act behind it or to play it like a chess game and play better than... But I think in the end, it's about making. The making is the only interesting part of architecture, so whether it's laws or buildings. But the interesting question is whether text can be so powerful than building, but I think you answered it somehow, that you wanted to implement like real case studies, no? Like physical case studies. But what was then the relation to the text?
Well, we worked very closely together with people from the administration. I don't think the architect should write the text. They are equipped to write the text, but I think you have to whisper these things into their ear and guide them in a way, and they will... I mean, a lot of people in the administration all of a sudden, A, said, well, oh, you're interested in us. So it is kind of blind body who's doing its job, but they have the feeling that they are not taken into account. So let's say the frustration already starts there. So text is, I think you can really, again, in a positive way, infiltrate into the text through individual projects, so individual practices. I mean, I think most practices here, or people from practices here present, do so in a very precise manner. But I also think that from public side, so again, government architect, at least in my definition, there's also a task, so not only private, I mean, why should Arno as a private office in a way invest, or why did we as a private office invest in trying to change the text, you know? To be macho, to say, well, look at what we've done, we're like... So we're not powerful enough, literally not powerful enough, and these examples are interesting, maybe also from an educational point of view, but they won't make the big difference on a policy level. So you need this extra level within the public domain, like a Baumeister, I think, who can actually, in a way, be a complement to this kind of efforts. So again, I believe in the power of architecture, but it's very limited as well once you try to move to a higher level. And I think it's our task to move to this highest level if you want to have a real impact on the public good.
Then, one. I saw the next one behind.
Peter, I would like to add something. Hello. To your maybe frustration or just having enough of all the energy going into competitions, you know, and being judged by, in a more or less democratic way, by commissions. So the only thing what I can say, and I think people acting here in Switzerland are much more privileged than in all other countries, but we are also building in PPP kind like projects in France or in Germany. I think for young people not willing to invest, let's say 90% in the beginning or 100% of their energy in competitions, there might be a way that you just are trying to find your work by yourself. And, you know, legislation is one thing. I mean, I know reading the book is a bit, for me, it's a little bit naive. Christian more thought of it to find gray zones to do the architecture he wants. I think it's not to be meant that you have then more possibilities. But I think you can find, even if you are looking at the mapping of cities, so-called lost angles, lost spots in the kind of hidden consciousness of the cities, which you can research where it belongs to. And maybe it belongs to almost nobody. Maybe it belongs to Tiefbauamt of Zurich, or the Tiefbauamt doesn't even know that it belongs to them, or it's the SBB. And you start to do a project, and you try to find money. You know, I think even to have a better knowledge about economy is maybe much more worthwhile than to know so much about law. Because if it, you know, it there is, and then you can go on and you can go on, and maybe there is a new generation of young architects. It's not anymore something for us, but developing their own projects. Because I mean, it's also a fact that about 30% of the people going away from the ETH are not becoming designing architects, but they go to developers, to administration, to firms having own building departments, you know, and they are really influential. They are really incredibly influential. So we could learn a lot maybe from artists, from the artist circles, about finding our own work, not going over the institutional ways. Let's say, for instance, competitions.
Maybe I just want to attach with the speeches before, if you speak about the power of architecture, and there's also always this observation, the question whether the architecture should is passive, which follows the laws and the political constitutions, or architecture is politically engaged, where just and also this gap that the architecture of architecture is different from the architecture of laws and architecture of politics. So can I see this engagement of architects into the political field as attempt to protect architecture being political, or is it attempt to try to find a collective with a common understanding that this different understanding of architecture could be emerged together?
I would go for the second possibility for sure. It's a collective.
Well, let's do it together like this. I think there's an old position linked to architecture, and there's a new position linked to architecture, whether we like it or not. And the old one is a very protected one, produced really intriguing, beautiful things, but we're running behind in society. It's as simple as that. And again, I think what really struck me, for instance, when I was, I presided a lot of juries during those 5 years. What really struck me is how clients, public clients, but also private ones, look at architecture. I mean, the role of the architect, and it's very instrumental in their eyes most of the time. It's not what we think we should, what we believe that it should be. But gradually, once they're in the project, they start to understand that it's much more complex and much more valid. But still, I think our architecture has this kind of, and so if we have nothing to lose in a way, and I don't mean this in a pessimistic way, we can open up the field of architecture altogether in a rather radical way. If architecture wants to play a crucial role in society, which I think it has to do, and maybe it sounds a bit overdramatic now, I think we have to find ways to work together with other people, other stakeholders, and to see architecture as a means. But this means that you as an architect or future architect, you will have to look differently towards the capacity of architecture. I see in a lot of schools, for instance, that architecture is still taught as a kind of final station, an end. I think that's in a way underestimating the capacity of architecture. And there are no truths, there's a panopticon of possibilities of how to work within architecture. But still, I feel that there is a big dictum on there's only one way of being a real architect, a true architect, you have your own office and all these things. I think there are at least 100 other interesting possibilities. And that's also, for instance, why I, in the end, I accepted this Baumeister position, which I turned into something which maybe was more my kind of fascination than anything else. But I think it was worthwhile. It was real public service. And we perform public service, even when you work for a private client. I'm not sure if it's an answer to your question, but because I see you.
Thank you, Peter. It's just a very short comment, but it was trying to kind of process, in a sense, the question that you've asked all your speakers and then Arno's response. And it seems to me one of the really interesting questions that is maybe the kind of meta thing is about our literacy in reading where the power lies. So partly in legislation and the administration, but particularly as architects, how to read the city, how to read the environment, how it's made. I'm always amazed when I come here that you walk through the front door and the weight of the door reminds me how powerful this institution is. If it wasn't as powerful, the door wouldn't be as heavy. And the whole world is made like that. And I think that as architects, if we are to be more politically engaged, I think we've got to be more literate at reading where the signs of power lie. Historically, as I think quite a few of Arno's examples show, you can see it in how a cornice is carved, you can see it in how a window is made, how a pavement is laid, how wide a road is. And I think that we are less good than we should be, than perhaps we have been as a culture, to read that and therefore to affect it, to find the cracks, to find the unmovable boulders, to find the spaces for actions. And so, to some extent, it's not really, in my mind, about whether a competition is good or not good. It's to what extent it is effective within this system. And I think that the way that, not just the way that we design things, but particularly the way that we look at things and record things, could be much more finely tuned to the power structures that are essentially making our environment.
Much more diverse.
Yeah.
I mean, again, the way of practicing architecture is still it's quite limited. And maybe the title I prefer not to, although we can imagine lots of interpretations, is maybe also to try to resist to a certain extent that is one absolutely so-called.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it includes even things like being able to read how a city repairs itself, for example. I find it fascinating doing a commute, a kind of a small European commute every week, but the way in which Zurich repairs itself, when you see maintenance, when you see infrastructure being done at the railway station, the confidence of the state is so powerful. You know, yeah, where late at night when you see a platform being rearranged, the number of people, the number of lights, the amount of equipment at play compared to something, let's say, in Britain, where infrastructure is more or less broken, where it's a couple of blokes and a hammer, you know, and a little bit of cement, hoping that it will last until next week. It's goes very much back to your film about where does the power lie? And who is actioning that? And I think as architects, if we're going to initiate projects, if we're going to participate in competition systems, have direct commissions, we've got to be aware and literate about how all of this kind of makes itself in the city or in the environment more generally.
So the end, I will end. The EDH is really a powerful institution that includes the students. Otherwise, it wouldn't function as a school. So imagine a school without students, it's nothing. That's one point. The other is the interviews we made for the film, like the one we did now, were completely unprepared for the one who gave the interview. So it means in the end, we have to cut in a way that it's like really working out. And therefore, I would say it's a kind of really huge collective knowledge that's available here in the EDH. And that makes it really interesting, even if the kind of positions are very differing. And that makes it even more interesting. So as we have the election evening, I have three more images to let you go to the party. So for sure, Mr. Trump shaked a lot of hands, although with Netanyahu in his private rooms in the 38th floor. That's his family and his wife. That's interesting. It might be, we don't know yet, we have to look at the first numbers. It might be that she will become first lady of the United States. And she claimed, interesting enough, she claimed in her biography that was online till some days ago, till a week ago. At the age of 18, she signed with a modeling agency in Milan after obtaining a degree in design and architecture at university in Slovenia. There's only one architectural university in Slovenia. They said she was inscribed for two semesters and she never, more or less, never showed up. She never made a degree. So look how interesting it might be to act as an architect, becoming first lady.